Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Adrienne Gilliard with Sandra Bazan, and we're from the ELC's inclusion team bringing you Behavior Bites Tidbits. This month of July, we're talking about some key things that contribute to the social emotional wellness and being able to apply teacher adaptations to support and minimize challenging behaviors. Last week, we talked about temperament. This week, we're going to talk about trauma and the responsive caregiving that we can give to children. We felt that this topic was extremely important because in 2019, the CDC provides research recognizing that up to 2/3 of the United States children have experienced at least one type of serious childhood trauma, such as abuse, neglect, natural disaster, or experienced or witnessed some type of violence. And trauma is possibly the largest public health issue that is facing our children today. The dictionary defines trauma as an emotional upset, and it can be physically, emotionally, mentally stressful experience that takes place in the life of an individual. And trauma can change how the brain processes those experiences. Now, we all had different sensitivities. We all experience things differently. So what may be traumatic for one child may not necessarily be traumatic for another. When we think about our trauma responses, our trauma responsive approach, and it responds to the impact of traumatic stress on children, the families, the caregivers, everyone that is in that particular situation. We think about how we can incorporate increasing that trauma awareness, the knowledge, and the skills, and incorporating them into our daily classroom practices. So today, Sandy and I are going to take a look at providing 8 global strategies that can help, you know, you support the children in your classroom.
Right, Adrienne. And I think it's important that we understand why the global strategies. The global strategies is because 2/3 of all children have experienced some type of traumatic event. And as we know, it's a scale. And you spoke about, you know, what may be traumatic to you may not be as, or that traumatic to me in that scale. But let's talk about behavioral responses. The way that you respond to trauma might be completely different to the way that I respond to trauma. So there's a lot of moving pieces, right? And so you need to understand first and foremost, excuse me, as educators that, you know, neurobiologically, a student cannot learn if they are in a trauma response, if they are in that triggered state, right? And what does that triggered state look like, right? We know, you know, flight, you know, fright, freeze, right? So that's your trauma response. That's that alert stage. None of us, and we can't expect our littles either to be able to do both. Our brains are not, they're not made that way, right? So then what can we do as educators to kind of create an environment where globally all of our students are receiving this, what we like to call now, like trauma-informed responsive care, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think it's really important that the very first thing is that we understand not to take things personal.
Absolutely.
Right? So the first one, Adrienne, was...
Expect unexpected responses.
Well, it's trauma-based, right? So they're not going to respond the way that you would typically expect somebody to respond. It might be an explosive behavior out of nowhere. He was fine just now. He was fine. I don't know what happened. He just started crying. Or I have no idea what happened. All of a sudden, he just started flipping a chair and that was it. He was having a good time. They were playing. They were fine. You've heard these stories over and over again when we talk to our teachers, right? Mm-hmm. And so what we need to understand is all of the triggers. And what is a trigger exactly? Well, it could be anything. And that's what makes trauma-informed and that sensitive care, that responsive care so complicated, that triggers can be literally anything. It could be a smell. It could be a sound. It could be a picture. It could be the sound of a voice. It could be something as, you know, a color. The color that somebody is wearing might trigger a response, right? So, oh my gosh, that's so overwhelming for me as an educator. Uh-huh. So my thing is to understand and expect the unexpected. So as I get to know my children, I'm starting to be more and more aware of different triggers. It's almost like the expect the unexpected for me is a signal for me to put on those detective glasses, right?
Right.
So I'm looking at kids like, what just happened? And I'm taking that ABC data. I'm looking for different things that might have caused this unexpected behavior. And now let's talk about these unexpected behaviors, right? We talked last week about temperament. And so this is how it gets linked. So based on that child's natural temperament, that's going to be the unexpected behavior, typically, right? So if you have one of those, what do we call them? Those very reserved, those very...
Slow to warm up
children. If they're being triggered, they might go and hide underneath the table. They might actually shut down and do nothing. Say nothing. You can't get a response. You can't get them to move. They might drop to the floor, dead weight, nothing, and not respond at all, right? Then you have those, what did we call them last week? Feisty children. What do you think they're going to do if they're being triggered and it's a trauma response and it's explosive? Well, if it's explosive and you're feisty, teachers might need to duck. There might be a chair being thrown across the room. A block might be thrown. You know, you might have one of those really raging, screaming tantrums, right? What about those other children that are kind of, you know, like they have even temperament? Well, those might be the ones that are just crying all the time, or you don't know what's going on. You know, like you just really don't, we can't tell, but they're not themselves, right? They're not quite themselves, you know? And so these are the things that I want our teachers to kind of understand, and then to make sure that they do not take it personal.
Gotcha. So
be the detective in that
situation.
Yeah.
Okay. The second strategy would be employing thoughtful interactions. What does that look like?
Gosh, Adrian, you know how we keep on talking about that bottom layer of the pyramid? It always comes
back. We always circle back to it.
Well, at that bottom layer of that pyramid, it is rapport, relationship building. This is, you need to take, you have to be explicit, you have to be intentional, and you have to really, you know, be student specific in your interactions with this child, right? So, you know, in any interaction, I'm 50% of that interaction.
Right.
And so if what I am doing is causing that other, if what I am doing, if the way that I am interacting with this child is causing him to explode, then I've got to own that 50%. And now I've got to look at the way that I approach that child. So having, you know, student-specific interaction strategies. And these are things, Adrian, that are typically not, you know, documented anywhere. You know, like, for example, I've always been able to have a really good rapport with my students, right? Like, especially those challenging behavior students. Why? Well, because I kind of always gave them choices. I never came at them like, you have to understand who you're dealing with. And then I always say, come through the back end. So for example, my son, ADHD, literally ADHD, oppositional defiance disorder. So for him, I would always give him options and give him, you know, I always made it seem like he was in control, right? So I gave him choices. That's one way of doing, of just being intentional in how you're going to interact with this specific student. So if I know, Adrian, you don't like to be told what to do, maybe I can ask you to do it in a way that I get what I need, the task to be done, but I present it in a way that it's easier for you to swallow. So instead of saying, Adrian, I need you to pick that up now, maybe I could say, hey, Adrian, could you help me? Could you pick that up before lunch? Mm-hmm. I now gave you back that power. I'm not telling you when to do it. I'm asking you nicely. It's not a directive. You know what I'm saying? It's understanding how you're going to deal with this one child individually. And so now as a teacher, you've got to do that with every single student.
With every single student. And so what that means is, so you know, the one that we just tackled was employ thoughtful interactions. But what you've also done in employing thoughtful interactions is also you're more specific about that relationship building, which would have been our third one. So I think you've covered.
Because they go hand in hand.
Because they go hand in hand.
Hand in hand. Like there's a, so you know how I just said you have to do that with every single kid now? Now, listen, I know as a teacher, right? I've got how many kids? You want me to do what now? You want me to have yes, I want you to have one-on-one interactions with every single one of your kids. There's this strategy that I just read about, which was phenomenal. Mm-hmm. You know, it's called the 2x10 rule.
Okay.
2 minutes a day, 10 days consecutively. Set the standard. I'm going to talk to you, Adrian, about things that you're interested in. I'm not going to talk to you about your behaviors. I'm not going to talk to you about anything academic. I'm not going to talk to you about, you know, you have to make green choices. You have to, no. Adrian, what does Adrian love to do? I'm going to have some quality 2 minutes interactions with Adrian for 10 days. And I'm going to make it so that she expects that, right? I'm also going to do this a couple of times during the year, especially after Adrian has a really bad maladaptive behavior. Every time Adrian has a bad behavior, I'm going to push in and give her my 2 minutes of, I'm into you. I want you to know that that behavior, I get it, you're safe, because I'm still building that rapport. I need to make sure that this student specifically understands that our relationship is not based on her behavior. Things that I want. It's child-centered. It's all about being intentional with that student and pushing in those. So those students that, you know, have a hard time during those long breaks, like they come back from Christmas break or winter break or spring break or a long weekend and they're just off. That's when I would push in. That's when I would give you an extra 2 minutes of like, hey, let's talk about it, just to connect again. Because we know studies have shown that it's about building that safety connection, right? Mm-hmm. So especially if I become that child's safe space, if I become that child's safe person, they're gonna have less of those explosive behaviors with me because I'm trusted. Does that make sense?
It makes a lot of sense. That makes a lot of sense. And you said that's called 2x10, right?
2x10, 2 minutes.
2x10. And like you said, the child is expecting it. So they're expecting it. So promoting predictability and consistency.
Which is the next strategy.
Absolutely.
We talk about it all the time. You know, those children that are anxious, we don't know why they're anxious. We have no idea, right? But we know that they need a little bit more warning. So let's throw up those visuals. Let's throw up that visual schedule, right? Let's talk about changes, because you know those kids. We've all had those students that if you said, Miss Adrian, that we are going out to the playground and we're going to have water play because Miss Adrian said that we're going to have water play. And you know that you have a student in your classroom that if you don't follow through, I'm gonna have an explosive reaction because God knows what I have lived in my little life, right? Mm-hmm. And that's not for us to determine like how hard that trauma was. Again, it's perceptive, it's perception, right? So if I was you, Miss Adrian, I would tell Sandy in the classroom, Sandy, it looks like it's going to rain. However, I know that we were supposed to go out and do water play. If it rains, then I will bring water play inside.
Right.
So now I've been preemptively gave that little girl, Sandy, who is looking forward to going outside, who doesn't take change really well, who needs to know next things, who I know is going to be really, really, really upset that she didn't get to go outside for water play. Now I've just given her a heads up, there might be a change, but if there is, I got you covered. We're going to bring it inside. It's going to be all right. No need to worry. I got you covered. So now that anxiety, that angst, that again, the building up of the trigger, the shaking of the, you know, of the soda can.
Yes.
You know, that we don't know the shaking of the soda can. Do we go over that analogy? So these kids are like, if you think about kids with trauma, like these explosive behaviors, you don't know in a soda can, not the glass bottles, because glass bottles, you can kind of tell, right? Like if you get a can of soda and you put one on a counter and the other one, and you shake one and not the other, can you tell which one has been shaken?
No.
No, right? And so every trigger, whether it's a sound, whether it's, you know, whatever the trigger is as if you shook that child. Let's say the child is the can, right? So you shook the child. And then all you don't know if it's been shaken until you open it. And that's the last straw. So when the student's like, I don't happen. We were having a good time. And all of a sudden, Adrian just flipped a chair. Well, she's been shaken all morning. You just didn't know that she was being shaken, and she reached her threshold, and now she's exploded. And now she has an unexpected behavior, and you're left wondering, oh, what just happened, right? So if we think about it like that and not take that personal and try to be more investigative. How do you say the word? Investigative? If we put that research, if we put those goggles on and like, okay, what is it? What was it? What was it that caused that explosion? And maybe then have that push in, because now remember, after every explosive reaction, I'm going to push in with those 2 minutes. And I'm gonna ask questions, and I'm gonna, what happened and how did your body feel? And let's talk about it. And what made you so angry? And they might not know.
Right.
They might not know. But you also provide that sense of calm and that sense of security, and you're okay, and I'm a safe space, and you are loved.
Right. And like you said, they may not know. And one thing that we do know about children who have experienced trauma is they tend to focus on the negative, and they do engage in inaccurate thinking a lot. So one of the strategies that you can help with that is teaching them how to change the channel. So tell us what that looks like when you teach them how to change the channel.
Well, it's a phenomenal thing. When I was in the classroom, I used to tell the kids that they have these superhero like traits, right? That you're a superhero. You are in control of you. You are in control of your behaviors. And so if you give that power back to them and tell them, you know, your brain is like a TV, and you have the power to change the channel, their eyes kind of get like this, they could become enlightened, right? Because sometimes when you're in those negative, it's almost like they perseverate on the negative thoughts.
Yes.
And so if you send the kid to go take a break, right? And you don't know what they're thinking, you have no idea, right? But if it's a trauma-based response, that child may be just ruminating. Mm-hmm. Have you ever had those kids that something happens in the morning, and then way later in the afternoon, they're still triggered by it. They're still upset. They've been ruminating about that thought, those feelings, over and over and over again. Okay, so now what do we do for that? Well, you know, we know that your brain can't do two things at once. Your brain cannot be in that, you know, that alert state, that freeze, flight, fight state, and be doing other more present moment, the tasks. So for example, anything with the senses. So maybe saying something like, okay, I want you to go take a break, but while you're here, Adrian, I know your favorite, what's your favorite color, Adrian?
Yellow.
Adrian, I want you to look at this book, and I want you to find all the pictures that you can find in yellow. Maybe not a book. Adrian, you know what? I can see you're really upset. Let's try to, right? Adrian is really, really upset. Adrian is really, really mad. But if I give her another task to do before she rages, right? Well, once she's in a rage, that's a whole different story. But we're talking about being preemptive, right? I know that Adrian is starting to get built up. I'm starting to see, I see her bodily triggers. Let me see if I can switch that mindset. Let me help her change the channel. So Adrian, can you do, we're looking for everything in the classroom that does, it's the letter A for Adrian, is what else in the classroom can you find that starts with the letter A? Mm-hmm. You take out an alligator, you go find the letter A. You know, maybe even more creative with their hands, giving them something to pound, right? So now you're getting all that anger out. But you don't just send somebody who's having these negative thought patterns and that you know was having, that they ruminate over it without giving them the strategy to change their channel. And right. It can be simply, you can even simply, once you, and it's all about giving these strategies before they need it, right? So like, again, you're not teaching these strategies I'm not telling Adrian in the middle of a rage, change your channel. And that's the first time she's ever heard Miss Sandy talk about change the channel, right? I'm gonna have a really amazing time in my morning circle when we're all friends and happy, and we're gonna talk about change the channel, and I'm gonna make a game out of it, and maybe I have a pretend remote control. And now, you know, like, let's have fun with it. It doesn't have to be so. And so now I've already given Adrian that verbal cue. I might have a pretend remote control in the cool down area, right? And I might just point to her and, you know, kind of like, change your channel, Adrian. Change your channel. I might have a visual of a remote control. The whole world knows what that means because I've taught it. I'm going to point to it, right? And so now Adrian now has a visual, a gesture, and she already knows that she has the power to change the channel. And Adrian's changing of the channel might be completely different from Bobby's changing of the channel. Adrian, you like the color yellow. Bobby might need to, draw it out. Bobby might need to jump it out. I don't know what Bobby might need, right? But everybody is individualized. And that's what we mean by change the channel.
All right. I like that. And so the other thing with those children that are constantly, you know, interpreting that negativity and that negativity is amplified, the next strategy that's global is giving supportive feedback to reduce that negative thinking.
Yeah, you got to understand these, like, these kids are, and not just the kids, right? Just people in general, because remember, two-thirds of children mean two-thirds of adults, because those children grow up. Right? We always forget that part. So two-thirds of people out there are walking around with all of these negative thoughts. And so, Adrian, if I happen to tell you, and let's just say you are a child who only hears the things that you do wrong at home, right? You know, you're messy, you're loud, you're this, you're that, you know. And again, we don't have control over that. But right. If you're that child, right, and that's one of your triggers, and you coming to my classroom, and it could be something as easy as, oh, Adrian, you know, oh, honey, you were supposed to color that. Remember, we said we were going to color all the triangles green. You colored it red. You know, let's correct that. What you might have heard was, you know, I'm not good enough. I'm always wrong. I always do everything bad. I'm bad. I did it wrong again. You know, like, so how do we go about fixing that? Right. Like, what, like, we have to give criticism. That's part of our job. That's part of, like, how we teach, right? You know, like, they make mistakes, you help. Okay. But we got to take it from a perspective of, like, these are really raw and raw souls. Right. And so you said something the other day in another one of our tidbits about a sandwich, that positive reinforcement, like that sandwich. So you say something positive. I love the way that, oh my gosh, Adrian, you colored everything in the lines. I love the way that you colored. That's awesome. We were supposed to color the triangles green. But I love that you made them, you know, like that they're all the same color. And so we're going to sandwich that creative critique in the middle, but we're going to make that such a beautiful, we're going to create a positive and then another positive. So it's going to be easier to swallow.
Exactly. That criticism, right? Is not harsh.
And we're also going to look for opportunities just to praise. You know, like, it's really not a big deal. It's really not a big deal. So, you know, if it was an activity for following directions, absolutely. She didn't follow directions. Okay, great. But if it was just, you know, color, you know, you just wanted the task to be done and it was a suggestion, not necessarily needed it to be done that way, let it slide, maybe. I don't know. We also need to understand that not everything needs to be criticized.
Absolutely.
And you get more, what's the saying? You get more with honey than you do with vinegar.
You get more flies with honey than you do with vinegar. Absolutely. So,
and add that to our little, you know, tool belt as well as for teachers.
Yes. And so you also said you use that as opportunities to just give praise. And so when you use that as opportunities to just give praise, that is also recognizing the areas of strength in your students. And it is a really good way to combat that poor self-concept that they may have, which is our next strategy, which is creating islands of competence.
Yeah, and what does that look like? Hey, listen, Adrian, every single one of us has a strength and every single one of us needs, we grow, like we, it's like a plant, right? You water the seed and they start to grow. So if you, for example, if you have a student who struggles sometimes with behaviors, right? But is really good with sitting down and academic tasks, make that student that struggles with behavior sometimes, make that student like a peer support, right? Uh-huh. So you have that child maybe buddy up with another one that has struggles with following one step directions academically, you know, and now you're pouring into the positives, you know, like you do really good with following directions when I'm telling you what to do when we're doing our small table. Do you think you can help Tommy over here? And so now instead of I'm always bad, I'm always this, I'm always that, I'm drawing on that child's particular strength. Mm-hmm. And highlighting that, right? And so now I'm giving more opportunities to combat those negative self-thoughts.
Right.
So every opportunity that I can give this child to change their self-narrative, because what we know about trauma is that it changes the way that we view ourselves.
Yes.
And it changes the way that we view others. It changes the way that we view our environments. And it changes our reaction to all three of those. Mm-hmm. And so if we can give these children more and more opportunities to highlight like their positives and their superpowers, right? Then we're on the right track to helping them heal.
Absolutely.
You know, from trauma.
Right. And a lot of that is about how teachers communicate when it comes to behavior. And so this goes right into our final global strategy, which is limiting exclusionary practices.
You know, I said it for like where we all say it, right? Behavior is communication.
Absolutely.
And so our students communicate their feelings by the way that they behave. But what we need to understand as educators is they're watching us. Yes. And our reactions and our behavior towards their behavior is communication, right? And so it's as easy as validating somebody. I see that you're having a really hard time. I see that you're angry, and not simply ignoring the behavior, though you don't want to give maladaptive behavior the attention, right? Mm-hmm. You don't want to give the behavior the attention, but you want to make sure that that student is seen and validated, or that they feel seen and validated. So right. Adrian, I see that you're having a hard time. I can tell that you're frustrated. I can tell that you're angry. I am here when you are ready. Remember, I'm pointing to the remote control. I'm pointing to the remote control. I'm trying to get her to change, you know, like I'm giving her, I'm trying to, all the strategies, right? I have already taught them. I am now just giving her gentle reminders from a safe place. And I'm not ignoring her. I mm-hmm. am ignoring the behavior. I am not going to tell her, stop screaming. I understand you're angry, Adrian. And then I might point to a visual where, you know, there's a rose and she knows to smell the roses and blow out the candle. Right. Absolutely. And so these are all the things, it all comes together. And then at the end of that, I'm pushing in. Remember, I think that that's the biggest takeaway is uh-huh. that final push in. It's that final connection again, because what we know is that when we feel safe, we are able to limit those explosive behaviors. We're able to self-regulate. We're able to kind of like come from a different place. And that's what we need to understand as teachers.
You know, absolutely.
It's not personal. It is not personal. And if you take account for your 50% of this interaction, and I can change what I'm doing, because what I'm doing is not working for you, Adrian. Mm-hmm. And I take that onus, right? If I take that into account, I can make a lot of changes globally in my classroom.
Absolutely. Wonderful. So just as a quick little recap, the 8 global strategies that we talked about were expecting unexpected responses, employing thoughtful interactions, being specific about the relationship building that we're doing with our children, promoting predictability and consistency, teaching strategies to change the channel. I love that one, Sandy. giving supportive feedback to reduce those negative thoughts, and creating islands of competence, and finally limiting exclusionary practices, which all works together to foster a feeling of safety and security for those children who've had traumatic experiences. So as always, if you are experiencing challenging behaviors with any of the students in your classrooms, you can always reach out to Debbie Kay on our warm line, where the number is 954-295-0672. If you found this video helpful and others of our videos helpful, please like, share, and subscribe. And we'll see you back here next time.